Well, good morning again, everyone. Thanks again for tuning in and with us. Big thanks again to so many people behind the scenes that kind of make all of this happen. Cameron, kind of in the sound room and audio-visual room right now, kind of running things. Greg, who worked to kind of be able to give us the opportunity to kind of switch some of our screen views back and forth a little bit, so you can see more of the screen, less of me, and which is a good thing, and those kinds of things. So just thank you for so many, Carrie, who had a little bit of fun, and if you were on our Facebook page, saw that we had a little bit of an audience here this morning. They were all stuffed, but hey, you know, we'll take what we can get right now. But again, thanks for spending time together in front of your screens. Most importantly, thank you for spending time together with our God. And I pray that today he speaks his words into your heart, not mine. But anyway, I hope you've had a good week. I know it's been kind of crazy, and we've been reduced a little bit more to how much interaction we can have and those kinds of things. But I'm just grateful that we get to do this this morning together. So thank you. If you're joining with us for the first time today, one, thank you for doing that. But I just want to kind of bring you up to speed and kind of refresh everyone's memory real quick. We've been walking through the story of the days and the hours leading up to the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus. And these events and incidents, they were predicted by the prophet Isaiah some 700 years before they even happened. And I thought, that's just incredible. Here, let me just share with you a few of the predictions that Isaiah made about the coming Messiah. The end of 52, chapter 52 of Isaiah, the end of it, and 53 has been where we've kind of focusing. But here's some of the things that Isaiah said about the Messiah that would come 700 years later. He said that he, the Messiah, would be highly exalted. He would be born and grow up. He would be despised and rejected. And then last week we saw that Isaiah predicted that the Messiah would remain silent and not defend himself when accused and sentenced to death. And so today, we're going to return to Isaiah 53, verse 7, and we're going to take a closer look at this particular line from that verse. And it says this, in Isaiah 53, 7, this one line we're going to zoom in on this morning: he was led like a lamb to the slaughter. And so before we kind of jump off and zoom too tight in on this line, let me remind you of some of the earlier words from Isaiah 53 that kind of leads us and sets us up for this, right? Isaiah 53, 1 begins this way: who has believed our message? To whom has the Lord revealed his powerful arm or his great work? Man, that's a really powerful question, a good question. Who has God revealed this message of the Messiah to? And are we listening to that message, right? He goes on, my servant grew up in the Lord's presence like a tender green shoot, like a root in dry ground. There was nothing beautiful or majestic about his appearance, nothing to attract us to him. He was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, acquainted with deepest grief. We turned our backs on him and looked the other way. He was despised, and we did not care. Isaiah says, yet it was our weaknesses he carried. It was our sorrows that weighed him down. And we thought his troubles were a punishment from God, a punishment for his own sins. But he was pierced for our rebellion. He was crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. He was whipped so we could be healed. All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We have left God's paths to follow our own, yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. And then we get to verse 7. He was oppressed and treated harshly, yet he never said a word. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. Hey, I know those of you that are at home, if you're in school still, you've been doing a lot of online school and stuff, but I'm going to ask you, if you won't mind, let's do a little bit of math this morning, if you don't mind. I know everybody just rolled their eyes, and okay, that, but it's going to be easy math. I think simple math, mostly. If you're probably, I don't know, like, they're so smart, so young, so maybe, I'm not going to put an age limit on this, maybe all of you can figure this out. But subtract 700 from 2020. All right, so 2020 minus 700. What do you come up with? I'll give you a second. 1,320, right? If our math is correct, 1,320. Do you know what was happening in and around AD 1320? You know, you could probably Google it later if you want, but let me just share with you a few of the things that was happening in and around the year 1320 AD. The Crusades had just concluded, right? So that's a whole crazy time in history, right? They had just concluded. The Byzantine Empire was still ruling the eastern part of Europe at the time. William Wallace had just recently battled King Edward I of England for the freedom of Scotland. And all of the Braveheart fans are like, yeah, I remember that movie. But it was an actual event that took place in and around a little before 1320. But here's the thought. What are the odds that anyone in that era could predict like the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr.? So if I was living in 1320, what are the odds anyone living in that era could predict the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. or the presidency of Donald Trump or maybe even the coronavirus pandemic, right? Yet think about this. Isaiah, writing 700 years before the birth of Jesus, not only predicted his death, but predicted that he would be led to his death like a lamb. What are the odds? Yet it happened. Matter of fact, all four gospel writers recognize the analogy. Matthew says, then they led him away to be crucified. Mark says the same thing in Mark 15:20. Then they led him away to be crucified. Luke records it this way, as they led Jesus away. John writes, so they took Jesus away. So think about this. Jesus was the living Son of God with all of the power of heaven available to him. He was not forced to the cross. He allowed the chief priests and the Roman soldiers to lead him to his place of execution, just like the shepherds were doing that very day as they led the Passover lamb up from the city of Bethlehem to be sacrificed in the temple. You see, the story of the Bible is the story of the lamb. As I was studying this out this week, it dawned on me that the prophecies and the foreshadowing of the Old Testament is a lot like doing a dot-to-dot page. You ever done one of those? You see what looks like arbitrary dots scattered all over a page, but you understand that there's a picture there, and it's a picture that slowly comes into focus, and it slowly comes together as you begin connecting the dots. God began laying out the dots, so to speak, through foreshadowing and prophecies from the very beginning. And the picture he was painting was a picture of his love and his grace, of a picture of sacrifice and substitution, a picture of redemption. Let me just share with you this morning some of the dots God was placing from the very beginning. God's picture of grace and sacrifice began all the way back in Genesis in the Garden of Eden with our first parents, Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve were in the garden and everything was perfect. And Scripture tells us that they were naked and not ashamed. That means that there was trust present, trust between one another and trust between them and God. And God had given them everything they needed, but he also gave them one restriction. It says this in Genesis chapter 2, verse 16 and 17. It says, God is speaking to Adam and Eve. He says, you may freely eat the fruit of every tree in the garden. Think about that, right? You may freely eat the fruit of every tree in the garden, except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And I know a lot of times when we view God's commands or whatever, a lot of times we look at those, oh, it's so restrictive and God's keeping us from enjoying a full life. And I'm like, you know, no, those commandments, those rules of sorts are in place as guardrails to keep us on a path of enjoying good life and full life and a life with him, right? And the part before he said, except, he said, you may freely eat the fruit of every tree. I mean, how incredible and how generous and how gracious is God. And because he's gracious and because he loves us, he says, however, there's an exception to this, and I want you to be aware of it. except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If you eat its fruit, you are sure to die. He gave a warning that was placed out of his love and his concern and his care for us. With Satan's help, Adam and Eve ate anyway. And Scripture says that in that moment, their eyes were opened. In that moment, trust was compromised. In that moment, relationships were fractured. In that moment, shame was introduced. And suddenly, Adam and Eve realize that they are naked and they're exposed. And so they sew fig leaves together to cover themselves. God, the Scriptures would tell us, was in the habit of walking and fellowshipping with Adam and Eve in the cool of the evening. But this time, when they heard him coming, they panicked and they hid themselves. And the scene really kind of goes from tragic to comic, because let's be real, how do you actually hide from God? He's God. He knows everything. But God kind of plays along. Adam, where are you? And Adam says, I heard you walking in the garden, so I hid. This is chapter 3, verse 10 of Genesis. I was afraid because I was naked. Who told you that you were naked? The Lord God asked. Have you eaten from the tree whose fruit I commanded you not to eat? At which point the human blame game was born, right? Adam pointed to his wife, you know, she made me do it. And then Eve points to the serpent, he made me do it. And in this moment, when Adam and Eve should have died, the Bible says God graciously stepped in. Look what it says, Genesis 3, verse 21. The Lord God made clothing from animal skins to what? To cover Adam and his wife. Where did God get animal skins from? A life was sacrificed, and blood was shed in order to redeem Adam and Eve, in order to pay for their sin and to cover their shame. The animal's life became a substitute for their lives. With that thought in mind, I'd love for you to jump to Genesis 22, and we're going to pick up another dot and the dots that God begins to display through prophecy and foreshadowing in the Old Testament. In Genesis 21, Abraham has a son in his old age, a son that he's been promised, a son that he's waited years for. Chapter 22 opens with God saying, Abraham, take your son, your only son, yes, Isaac, whom you love so much, and go to the land of Moriah. Go and sacrifice him as a burnt offering on one of the mountains which I will show you. And this made absolutely no sense to Abraham. But he trusted God. So Abraham and Isaac travel for 3 days to Mount Moriah, and then they make their way to a relatively flat section of the mountain where they leave two of their servants behind that traveled with them, and then Abraham and Isaac continue on a little further toward the top of the mountain. Isaac carries the wood, and Abraham carries a knife and the fire. Abraham builds an altar and straps his son to it. Then in the worst moment of his life, he raises the knife with the intention of bringing it down upon his son. And suddenly, in that very moment, God speaks again. Abraham, Abraham. Yes, Abraham replied, here I am. Don't lay a hand on the boy, the Lord said. Do not hurt him in any way. For now I know that you truly fear God. You have not withheld from me even your son, your only son. Then Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught by its horns in a thicket. So he took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering in place of his son. And at this crucial moment, when a sacrifice was called for, God provided a ram in place of Isaac. For all of us that didn't grow up on farms, a ram is a male lamb. And let me show you this next verse, as it is incredibly prophetic. Genesis 22:13, it says, Abraham named the place Yahweh Jireh, or Jehovah Jireh, which means the Lord will provide. And to this day, people still use that name as a proverb. On the mountain of the Lord, it will be provided. I thought that was interesting. Not it has been provided, but it will be provided. Remember that last line, because in this moment, God was placing a dot that he would connect in the most amazing way 2,000 years later. Let's journey forward in the story of the Lamb and find another dot displayed by God as he pulls this picture together. This time we're in Exodus 12. The children of Israel are in slavery in Egypt, and God wants to free them. So God sends Pharaoh, the ruler of the Egyptians, 10 powerful visual aids, to each of them designed to demonstrate that Jehovah God was superior to the gods, the many gods of Egypt. Chapter 12 tells the story of the 10th visual aid, the 10th plague. God is going to judge Egypt for their sins, but the only problem is the Israelites have sinned as well. So God says this to Moses: announce to the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, each family must choose a lamb or a young goat for a sacrifice. Take special care of this chosen animal until the evening of the 14th day of this first month. Then the whole assembly of the community of Israel must slaughter their lamb or young goat at twilight. They are to take some of the blood and smear it on the sides and top of the door frames of the houses. On that night, I will pass through the land of Egypt and strike down every firstborn son and every firstborn male animal in the entire land of Egypt. I will execute judgment, God says, for I am the Lord. But the blood on your doorposts will serve as a sign, marking the houses where you are staying. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. That's where we get that name, that word, Passover. Moses relays this message to every Jewish household, and he helps them understand the personal application of it. Right? There wasn't one person doing this for everybody. Each family had to take this on and apply this to their own household. They all chose a lamb. They would bring it into their home. They play with it and name it and bond with it and love it. And then on day four, the father of the household takes it outside and kills it. I don't know about you. I mean, just imagine the questions and the conversations happening with some of the children in those households. Dad, why did you do that? I mean, what did our lamb do to deserve that? The father would respond, nothing. He didn't do anything. He was innocent. We did things that were wrong, and God said we could pay for those ourselves, or we could substitute the innocent lamb for our sins. It was either the lamb or one of us. The Israelites were spared judgment by sacrificing an innocent lamb and applying its blood. God wanted the Israelites to remember the picture being painted on this day, so he told them this. This is a day to remember. Each year, from generation to generation, you must celebrate it as a special festival to the Lord. And so for the next 1,400 years, on the very same day, the Israelites sacrificed a Passover lamb to cover their sins, year after year after year. And they had to do it year after year after year because they kept sinning. And so they had to keep sacrificing. And these sacrifices continued as Israel moved into the promised land. And they continued after they were carried away into captivity once again into Babylon. They continued when they returned again to their homeland. The people longed for a permanent sacrifice, one that would pay for their sins once and for all time. But in the meantime, they kept sacrificing these innocent lambs. Prophets came and went, and from time to time they would talk about lambs and sacrifices. And then one day a prophet named Isaiah comes on the scene, and Isaiah spoke of a suffering servant, a Messiah, a Savior who would come one day and pay the ultimate price for our sins and pave the way for a relationship with God. In the 53rd chapter of his book, Isaiah, speaking of this coming Savior, wrote this: he was led like a lamb to the slaughter. You still with me? Isaiah said that Messiah would be led like a lamb to the slaughter. And people began to scratch their heads and wonder, could it really be that one day the lamb they longed for, the lamb that would provide the permanent solution and the permanent sacrifice for their sins, would actually be a man? Nobody really knew for sure. But there it was. In their sacred text, another dot in an ever-developing picture. Centuries passed, and people wondered. And every year, another lamb was slaughtered. One special night, in a city just on the outskirts of Jerusalem, God began connecting the dots. Can I show you something amazing? Let me read what is probably a familiar passage of scripture to many of you from Luke's gospel. Luke chapter 2, let me just read this to you. At that time, the Roman Emperor Augustus decreed that a census should be taken throughout the Roman Empire. This was the first census taken when Quirinius was governor of Syria. All returned to their own ancestral towns to register for this census. Sound familiar? And because Joseph was a descendant of King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home. He traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, to whom he was engaged, who was now expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no lodging available for them. Now listen to this. That night, there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified. But the angel reassured them, "Don't be afraid," he said. "I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David." Listen to this. "And you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth, lying in a manger." Did you catch that last line of the angel's proclamation to these shepherds? Let me put it up here for you. "And you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth, lying in a manger." What dots was God connecting in this? Why would this be a sign for these shepherds? Here's the thing. These shepherds weren't your ordinary run-of-the-mill shepherds. These were the shepherds in charge of the sheep that were set aside for the temple sacrifice. Their job was to take care of these sheep and to inspect the lambs that were born to see if they might meet the qualifications of the Passover lamb. A male lamb without spot and without blemish. Do you know what they would do when they believed a perfect lamb had been born? They would wrap them tightly in strips of cloth, and they would lay them in a manger so that the lamb would not thrash about and bruise itself or injure itself. The message from the angel to the shepherds that night was that the Messiah had come. The perfect Lamb of God has been born, and he has come to save us. 30 years later, Jesus would leave his carpenter shop in Nazareth and travel south along the Jordan River until he came to a place where a man named John was baptizing. John was in the middle of the river when he looked up and he saw Jesus on the shore, pointing to Jesus and declaring for all to hear, "Look," he said, "the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." This was an electric moment. This was a dot connecting moment. Suddenly, God's plan to reach and rescue mankind was coming into focus. This was the man, the Messiah, the Lamb of God, and he was going to lift the weight of the sin off of the world, finally and for all time. You probably know the rest of the story. For the next 3.5 years, Jesus teaches like no other. He heals like no other. He cares like no other. Then at the very moment that the Passover lamb was being led to its place of sacrifice, Jesus was being led up a hill called Golgotha, to die like no other. giving his life as payment for the sins of the world. In fact, he would be led to the location where Abraham had stood 2,000 years earlier when God provided a perfect sacrifice and substitution. With the last bit of oxygen left in his lungs, Jesus looked around at the people gathered there, thought about all the people who had ever lived, about all the people like you and I who would live one day, and he shouts this word in Greek, "Tetelestai," he would shout. In English, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Tetelestai is the word merchants wrote on sales slips when full payment had been made. Tetelestai means paid in full. Paid in full, no more payment required. Nothing more ever needs to be done to atone for the sins of the world. The author of the book of Hebrews writes this, "With his own blood, not the blood of goats and calves, he entered the most holy place once for all time and secured our redemption forever." The story of the Bible is the story of the Lamb who was slain for the sin of the world. Your sin and my sin permanently, once for all time. And while God connected the dots that day on the cross, the story of the Lamb and the story of those who will put their faith in Jesus as the sacrificial Lamb of God who paid for our sins is not over. You see, the story of the Lamb and the story of his people is not just the story of prophecies that God fulfilled from the past, but it is a story of the promises of God that he will yet fulfill in the future. 3 days after his resurrection, Jesus would rise again. 40 days after his, three days after his crucifixion, Jesus would rise again. But 40 days after his resurrection, Jesus would return to heaven to be seated at the right hand of the Father in a position of power and authority. And if we turn to the final book of the Bible, the book of Revelation, we'll find the story of the Lamb and his people continues. The disciple John is given a view to what I believe is the not-so-distant future and what it will look like. In Revelation 5:13, John writes, "And then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the sea, under the earth and in the sea, they sang, 'Blessing and honor and glory and power belong to the one sitting on the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever.'" The final two chapters of the Bible tells us that one day not only will the Lamb redeem our world, but he'll create a new one. Let me share with you a little bit of what that's going to be like. Revelation 21, verse 3, says John writing, says, "I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, 'Look, God's home is now among his people. He will live with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death, or sorrow, or crying, or pain. All these things are gone forever.' And the one sitting on the throne said, 'Look, I am making everything new.' And then he said to me, 'Write this down, for what I tell you is trustworthy and true.' And he also said, 'It is finished. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To all who are thirsty, I will give freely from the springs of water of life. All who are victorious will inherit these blessings, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. I saw no temple in the city,'" verse 22, "'for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. And the city has no need of sun or moon, for the glory of God illuminates the city, and the Lamb is its light. The nations will walk in its light, and the kings of the world will enter the city in all their glory. Its gates will never be closed at the end of day, because there is no night there. And all the nations will bring their glory and honor into the city.'" Let me read you another passage. Revelation 22, verse 3, "No longer will there be a curse upon anything." Man, let that sit on you. No longer will there be a curse on anything. Nothing's going to decay. Nothing is going to die. Disease is done. Death is done. Sorrow is done. Pain is done. For the throne of God and of the Lamb will be there, and his servants will worship him. And they will see his face, and his name will be written on their foreheads, and there will be no night there, no need for lamps or sun, for the Lord God will shine on them, and they will reign forever and ever. Then the angel said to me, and I love this last part, everything you have heard and seen is trustworthy and true. The Lord God, who inspires his prophets, has sent his angel to tell his servants what will happen soon. This is how the story of the Lamb and the story of his people plays out through eternity. In the most uncertain of times, we can be absolutely certain of God's love, of his purposes, and his plans. All the dots that he laid out and faithfully connected, he will continue to faithfully execute and connect. Let me share with you, though, there's one crucial caveat in all of this. There's one absolutely critical component connected to the Lamb. Revelation 21, 27 says this, "Nothing evil will be allowed to enter, nor anyone who practices shameful idolatry and dishonesty, says this, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life." This is the only way we gain entrance into the life that God offers to us and has for us. It is solely by placing our faith in Jesus, the Lamb of God, and believing on him. Jesus allowed himself to be led to the slaughter because he saw everything you and I needed in order to have what he wanted for us, the relationship, the life that he desired for us. He allowed himself to be led to the slaughter, and he determined that he would pay for the life that he wanted to offer us with his own life. Let me just ask you to let him into your life. Let him into your heart. And maybe today is the day that you accept Jesus and you place your faith in the Lamb that came to take away not only the sin of the world, but to take away your sin and restore you to a place of right relationship with God. If that's where you're at and that's what you understand you need to do today, you can pray with me from your heart and pray with your own words, but you can pray something like this. Lord Jesus, thank you for giving your life for me. I had no way to pay for my sin myself. I believe on you and accept your payment and your love for me. And I invite you to be my Savior and my Lord. If you prayed that today, if that's where your heart was at and you spoke or you prayed your own words and whatever that is, would you please connect with us and let us know? We would love to encourage you and to celebrate with you. Let me pray for all of us. And then as we sign off, I'd like to share a song with you that I pray will be a beacon of hope and a source of encouragement through today and through the days that come. Let's pray. Father God, I'm so thankful for your word. I'm so thankful that you began laying out the dots, so to speak, of this story, of this picture thousands of years ago. As you already knew what you were going to do because of your love and because of your grace to redeem mankind back to yourself, that you weren't going to ask for them to perform. You were going to step into our world and lay down your life for us. You were going to trade your life for ours so that we could inherit eternal life that you offer to us. God, in the midst of times that are troubling and uncertain, would you allow us to look back and see your hand, and see your faithfulness through generations as you continue to connect the dots, as you continue to share your love and your grace and your mercy and your story with all of us, to know that there is a God that created us, that loves us beyond all measure, and has done everything needed once and for all to pay for our sin, and all we have to do to step into relationship with the God of the universe is believe, to trust on Jesus and what he did for us, because we couldn't do it ourselves. God, we love you. We ask for your comfort and for your grace and for your peace, for your courage, for your strength in our lives in these days. God, help us be a beacon of hope. Help us be a people of encouragement. And we just pray all this in the matchless and the mighty name of Jesus, because he is worthy. Amen.
Do you feel the world is broken? Do you feel the shadows deepen? But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? Do you wish that you could see it all made new? Is all creation groaning? Is a new creation coming? Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? Does our God intend to dwell in